We have now the second part of our program, and I would like to invite to the table some people, but before to invite three ambassadors, I would like also to show you a special video of Johannes Hahn, Commissioner of European Neighbourhood Policy and Enlargement Negotiation. Is a video message just for this day, especially for this day and this WeMed event. So, there is somebody that could be some
Dear
indication.
Ladies and gentlemen,
thank you very much.
First of all, I regret not being able to be with you today, but I didn't want to miss the opportunity to express my support to the work that you are doing in this extremely important area of our cooperation. For nearly 10 years now, cross-border cooperation has played a key role in strengthening the economies of border regions, in protecting the environment, and more generally in bringing people together. At a time when borders are being portrayed as lines separating countries and people, it's particularly important to acknowledge the cross-border initiatives led by men and women who have decided to share ideas and values and to join efforts for improving their daily life together. The impact achieved is considerable and makes a real difference for citizens living and working in these regions. The strength of these programs lies in the fact that both member states and partner countries participate on fully equal terms, pursuing their respective priorities and interests, which very frequently they share in common. This has fostered a high level of enthusiasm, ownership, and commitment. The MED program is the largest segment in terms of geographical coverage and budget, with a total of 13 participating countries, 7 European Union member states, and 6 Mediterranean partner countries. This includes 98 territories covering 190 million people. The first generation of this program was worth 200 million euros and funded 95 projects involving over 730 Mediterranean organizations, mainly local and regional authorities, as well as civil society organizations. We targeted various sectors, including the creation of startups, enhancement of economic clusters, energy efficiency, better use of water resources, empowerment and inclusion of disadvantaged women, and waste management. The results have been very encouraging, so we aim to increase funding for the second generation of this program. In view of the political and economic turmoil of the last years in the Southern neighborhood, I'm convinced that cross-border cooperation is one of the most powerful tools we have to contribute to the stabilization of regions. This was, after all, the founding idea of the European Union. By strengthening economic ties across political borders, we reduce the possibility of conflict and get closer to our ultimate objective, the creation of a space where peace, democracy, and prosperity can thrive.
I cannot wholly agree with the Commissioner Hahn when they say that this is one of the most powerful tools to stabilize the region and to give hope to the people in Mediterranean. Now, to debate about this argument, this theme, there are two ambassadors. One is Raouf Saad, Egyptian ambassador, chairman of the National Steering Bureau Committee of Implementation of EU Partnership Agreement, naturally of the Egyptian Foreign Minister of Affairs, his ambassador. And from the Italian side, there is Ambassador Efisio Luigi Marras, Italian ambassador to Greece in Athens. Thank you very much. I would like to invite them to come here to the table and to speak. Thank you very much. Here. Non c'è, non è venuto. Non è venuto, ha detto. I don't know if Okay, there is a good news. There is a good news because is joining to us also Hani Al-Hayek, co-president of the Euro-Mediterranean Regional and Local Assembly, a major of Beit Sahour in Palestine. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much. Please. Okay, we talked before each other with the Ambassador Raouf Saad about this initiative. He's an experienced diplomat, and she knows very well this sector of the cooperation. I would like to know his opinion about his program, but also about what we hear today here in this morning, where we heard some very interesting testimonial about the cooperation between the Mediterranean countries, about the people of this region.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I wonder if you want me to engage in a kind of discussion with you or make my statement.
Well, you can make it as you like it.
All right. Let's articulate, you know, what just few points I want to make, but let me say that before I do that, I would like to express my deep appreciation to Greek authorities for hosting this meeting, and I think it's one of the distinct characteristics of the Mediterranean that wherever you go, you feel that as if you haven't traveled, you feel at home. And this is how we feel in Athens and Alexandria and Rome and Marseille. And this is something that brings the peoples of the region together much closer. I was very much attached to the topic that was chosen for this meeting. You know, I'm known very much that I'm one of the strong supporters of the CBC, not because for any personal feelings, rather than for an objective appreciation of what CBC means. But let's start because, you know, we are talking about globalization. I think after more than half a century of globalization, we have reached a critical point of history where we should pause, think, discuss, seek, and reach cooperative solutions, as it's being suggested, for building a stronger Mediterranean. In this context, we have to take into consideration that globalization has resulted in changing the very value system of international relations, whereby many established values like sovereignty, borders, nationalism have acquired different meaning in theory and practice. It's also obvious that globalization has produced positive developments, such as the promotion of regional economic integration, intercultural dialogue, increasing links among the peoples of the world, huge flow of information, and the promotion of the role of civil society organizations, etc. Meanwhile, negative effects. Again, you want me to scream? I don't know where to go. Okay. All right.
Most comfortable here.
Meanwhile, negative effects have been also facilitated by globalization, such as terrorism, illegal migration, human trafficking, organized crime, and even weakening the national sense of citizenship. It's useful in this regard to refer to the recent EC report, the European Commission report, on European economic forecast, which focuses on new backlash against globalization related to the increasing protectionist policies and doubts about the feasibility of economic globalization, which could be a real threat to global economic growth. That's what the report says. as well as linking globalization with the unequal distribution of wealth among and within different parts of the world. The Mediterranean region, unfortunately, might be the most influenced region by the overall effects of globalization, particularly the negative aspects of globalization, which have been amplified particularly in the past few years. Regrettably, the unprecedented developments occurring in the region have reached threatening dimensions and consequences that threaten the mere existence of a number of countries and are affecting equally both banks of the Mediterranean. In this regard, the EU and its southern Mediterranean partners shoulder an indispensable responsibility in restoring peace and stability to the peoples of the region at large. The endeavor in this part, this endeavor is not separate from the changing nature of the roles of the international and regional players in the region, within which, and this is I want to underline, that the EU is becoming a de facto front runner in the region in view of its huge interests in the region, as well as with unprecedented magnitude of common challenges between the two banks of the Mediterranean. We in Egypt strongly believe that EU-Egypt partnership is irreplaceable strategy for bilateral and regional cooperation, particularly after it has been enriched by the revised EMP, which strengthened partnership with necessary elements such as co-ownership, differentiation, tailor-made approach, etc., that could transform this partnership into a model and innovative cooperative solution. We recognize that the CBC program stands special, rather unique, in its concepts, organization, methodology, and tools, a combination that could provide an innovative cooperation solution uniquely tailored and targeted to serve the peoples of the two banks of the Mediterranean. The challenge before us today is how CBC could be a successful cooperative solution under globalization. This is the real challenge, as well as within different circumstances from those that surrounded the previous program. It's obvious that there is a major differences of the situation where and when we started the CBC and where we are starting the new phase of CBC starting January 2017. In this regard, cooperative solutions cannot be successful unless they are linked to the people's needs and able to produce clear results that would improve their lives and contribute to the development of local communities as well as to the country as a whole. Therefore, we are all invited, governments, peoples, institutions, to ensure efficiency, effectiveness, and assessment of results, flexible rules of implementation, and before that, increasing the awareness among the local communities of the returns of the projects that they are parties to. Judging by the past experience, we in Egypt believe that the CBC, in spite of its relative small volume and budget, could become a successful cooperative solution and a model that could be replicated in other parts of the world. Attaining this objective cannot materialize without a true spirit of partnership reflected in equality, transparency, pragmatism, and mutual respect among all parties. At the beginning of a new phase, we are challenged to prove that in spite of the backlash against globalization, there is still success stories under globalization. Do you allow me on your behalf to accept this challenge? We do. I think with the success that we have achieved, with the hope that we have seen today, I mean, I was extremely impressed, you know, with how simple things start and how productive they become and how the people people to people, are really engaged, involved in their projects, all what they needed, just a support. It's not a big volume of support, but it is a support that they needed in order to launch their projects. So I think what we have seen in the very few successful examples today is hope, a real hope. And I think the beauty of CBC, that it's not only, it's purely democratic model. I mean, partners choose their areas of cooperation. Partners choose themselves. From the other parts of the world, and they work together, and they bring, you know, positive results to all their own projects. So it's a real democratic, practical projects that they need our support. I cannot just conclude before expressing our deep gratitude to the government of Italy and to the region of Sardinia for the very instrumental support that they are providing to the CBC, and the mission they carry, you know, in order to serve the Mediterranean area in a very practical manner. I would like really to express our thanks, and with all my problems with MA still, I would like to thank them for a wonderful job they are doing, such a teamwork, you know. And you know, one good thing about them, they come together, they can create problems, but in a very collective manner. Still, we will continue cooperation, and we express deep appreciation for a very, very fine job that they are doing. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Saad.
May I ask you just to pronounce my name, Saad, because I'm not sad.
Saad.
All right?
Saad. Today we are learning many pronunciations, Greeks and Arabs and so on. So, Ambassador Saad, I really appreciate your speech, because you put in the right perspective the things. The picture outside and around is grim, you know very well. Because entire nations are going to crumble in this period. Iraq, Syria, Libya, that is a neighbor of Egypt. Before the Egypt, before the wars, missed Egypt. In Arab Misr. Before the war, there was more than 1 million of the Egyptian people working in Libya. There was more than 1 million of Tunisian people working in Libya. Before the war in Syria, there was millions of people working, for example, in the area of Aleppo, working in the textile industry. For Gaziantep in Turkey. There was a brilliant economy. There was some perspective for the future. Now, if you go in Aleppo or in the area, everything is destroyed. The social fabric is destroyed also. That is more important. So projects like CBCI, INAI, CBCI are very important. Because we cannot think that we can have only billions of dollars to make something. We need some time less, but real effective, something that could be an example for the people. So I hope that the project of the CBCI could be able to exploit also in the right way the globalization, as, for example, we are today with our testimonial and our friends. They are from small villages or small part of Middle East or of the Mediterranean, but they are connected with a globalized world. It's an example. Anyway, now I am happy to give the speech to Ambassador Efisio Marras. I hope that the pronunciation is right.
How do you say?
Efisio Marras.
Strong.
Strong, Marras.
Strong, Marras.
Marras. With the Marras. So, I make another mistake.
She knows.
So she knows. Anyway, thank you to Ambassador, Italian Ambassador in Greece, and I would like to hear his remarks about our event today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm very glad to be here because it will help us at the embassy in Athens to have been in touch with you. In the sense that what I would like to say in a few words is what I would like to do is to share our own experience here with the effort that the instrument is doing. And there are very common grounds. I will try to see it both on a European perspective and from, let's say, Mediterranean, North African, Middle Eastern perspective also. From the European perspective, we are in a country which is, it's not the only one, but which is struggling because it's difficult to keep being in a framework, in a European framework. At the same time, we have a project, the European project, which is slowing its path, which is in crisis. And one of the reasons is that, according to me, in Europe, we have forgotten that the European project started on a very strong bilateral basis, striking an agreement, a common action between France and Germany. It was a bilateral dimension upon which we built Europe. And what we have been doing in these long years is we have somehow lost the awareness of the importance of the intra-European community bilateral relations. And I'm saying this because I know the relations between Italy and Greece. We are geographically very close. We are culturally very close. But if we look closely at our relations, there is a lot more that we should do. And we have not done this also because, and I guess it's something psychologically, because we have thought, well, there is Europe. So we will be told how to manage and what to do. And this is wrong. So I'm trying, the whole embassy with our Greek friends, we are trying to strengthen the bilateral relations. And when we have to strengthen the bilateral relations, a very important role should be played by entrepreneurship. So in a sense, we are trying to do the same thing that the instrument we are talking about today is doing. And this instrument is extremely interesting for us. North Africa, Middle East, I guess there are dynamics which are very difficult dynamics taking place. And there too, the bilateral regional dimension is extremely important. to give opportunity to all of us to try, to work, and to grasp the profits of your work. Another remark, which comes from what I've said, is that, and I, again, I'm looking at the relation between Italy and Greece, there are very strong relations between regions of Italy and regions of Greece. And these relations are an asset, something extremely important that has to flourish. In other words, the national dimension is not sometimes the right perspective in the relation between two countries. And if I have time, I would like just to mention one thing, which is my experience in, I don't know if there are Maltese representatives here. Okay. I was ambassador to Malta some time ago, and I kept hearing complaints from private people, companies, university professors, because Italy, Sicily, was not working speedily enough with Malta in order to prepare projects for an instrument. Yes. So being newly appointed and ingenuo, I said, well, maybe I have to do something. So I went to the Prime Minister's office in Malta and saying, this is what I hear, is there anything I can do? And I was received with a lot of suspicion. A lot of suspicion. Then they realized that I was in good faith and I was really trying to do something nice. So at the end, the lady in charge told me, listen, we have problems, but please, between Malta and Palermo, you people from Rome, don't put your finger. So this is somehow shows the success of these programs.
People to people.
Beside this, I really indeed think that it is a powerful tool. I've read the sectors the instrument is working on, and they are the right ones. Maybe some synergies could be improved. Maybe some more private people, some more entrepreneurship should be taken into account. But it's a forward-looking tool. In the sense, let me add this, that I think we are in a time where the stability of the region, the prosperity of my neighbor, of my people and of my neighbors, is more important than the saving of a few pennies. So if I save some pennies importing something from very far, but my neighbor is not, could sell to me the same things at one or two pennies more, maybe it's worth buying it from him. One last thing, of course, underlying this effort, which is commendable, are values that have to be respected, and those are democratic values. Thank you very much.
I really appreciate the speech of Ambassador in Greece because he underlined the main problem, but also one of the way to go out from the problems that are the relation between the people, between the local people, that sometimes are able to overcome the national problem. We cannot hide, for example, that at this table we have a problem. We don't have, for example, now the ambassador, Italian ambassador in Egypt, in Cairo, after a long tradition of relations of decades. But we hope that in the near future we will have, and I am sure anyway that we can able to maintain relation, to improve also this relation, for example. And CBCI, programs like this of Europe, are the best way to maintain also the relation between the people, to improve the life of the people, and at the end also the comprehension between the two sides and between the sides. Now we have the third and the last of our speech from Hani Abdelmasih Al-Hayek, that is co-president, I don't know if it's right, president of the Euro-Mediterranean Regional and Local Assembly, ARLEM, the acronym, and major of Beit, Sahour, Palestine, Beit, Sahour. I know better, but Beit, Sahour, that this European Mediterranean Regional and Local, I would like to know, understand what is.
Beit Sahour.
Thank you.
Beit Sahour is from Palestine, so we are near Beit Lahem. We are 5 meters from Beit Lahem.
5 meters?
Yes. Not 5 kilometers. 5 meters across the road.
the microphone, please. The
microphone, you know.
Closer, a little bit closer.
I want to change to speak in Arabic. Sayyidati wa sada, أود أن أشكر المنظمين على دعوة الجمعية الإقليمية والمحلية الأورومتوسطية المعروفة باختصار أرلم. اسمحوا لي أن أبدأ بتقديم نفسي. أنا رئيس بلدية بيت صحور، وهي بلدية في فلسطين وشقيقة لبلدية بيت لحم في الضفة الغربية. ومنذ شهر فبراير وأنا أتولى منصب الرئيس المشارك للجمعية الإقليمية والمحلية الأورومتوسطية مع الرئيس السيد ماركو ماركولا من لجنة المناطق الأوروبية. أعزائي المشاركين، شهدت السنوات الأخيرة تحولات سياسية في منطقة المتوسط، والتي من شأنها إعادة تشكيل الجغرافيا السياسية للمنطقة بأسرها، والتي ما تزال نتائجها غير مؤكدة حتى الآن. وتبدو تلك التحولات كعمليات معقدة وطويلة الأجل، اتخذت مسارات متنوعة في العديد من البلدان. فمن التغيرات السلسة نسبياً التي جرت في المغرب والأردن، إلى حالة عدم اليقين السائدة في مصر، حيث استمر التوتر بين النظام السياسي وبين القوى الأصولية المتطرفة التي ظهرت بعد الثورة، إلى انهيار الدولة في ليبيا، والصراع المستمر في سوريا، واستمرار احتلال إسرائيل للأراضي الفلسطينية، إلى جانب بعض الأخطار التي تهدد باقي البلدان، ويتفاقم التوتر السياسي بسبب استمرار حالة عدم الاستقرار الاقتصادي، والذي يتأثر أيضاً بموجات الإرهاب، وهو ما يشكل تهديداً للتماسك الاجتماعي ويثير تحديات مجتمعية كبيرة. ومع ذلك فقد ازدادت القدرات المالية والإدارية للسلطات المحلية في العديد من البلدان. ونحن نتطلع إلى الانتخابات المحلية في فلسطين وتونس، وواثقون من الخطوة التي تم اتخاذها للأمام من خلال إقرار مبدأ التفويض الفرعي للسلطات في الدستور الجديد في المغرب. ونحن نشجع أيضاً الصمود الشجاع لرؤساء المدن الليبيين الذين يكافحون لتقديم الخدمات الأساسية للمواطنين. من الجانب الآخر، فإننا نرحب بتنامي اعتراف الاتحاد الأوروبي بالبعد الإقليمي لسياسته الخاصة بالجوار والدور الممنوح للسلطات المحلية والإقليمية من قبل المجتمع الدولي عندما يتعلق الأمر بمواجهة التحديات الكبرى مثل التغيير المناخي أو إدماج المهاجرين. واليوم سنحظى بفرصة لمناقشة وتبادل الأفكار بشأن التعاون عبر الحدود في منطقة البحر المتوسط، وهو موضوع ينبغي ألا ينحى جانباً كموضوع فرعي، لأنه أحد أنواع التعاون الإقليمي الذي يشكل جزءاً من سياسة التماسك الأوروبية ضمن حدود الاتحاد الأوروبي، كما أنه أيضاً أحد المكونات الأساسية لسياسة الجوار الأوروبية ENB. وفي الحقيقة فإن التعاون بين تلك المناطق التي لديها حدوداً أرضية أو بحرية مباشرة مع الاتحاد الأوروبي ونظيراتها في جانب الاتحاد بجانب الاتحاد الأوروبي من الحدود يعتبر بالغ الأهمية من أجل معالجة التحديات المشتركة التي تم تحديدها بشكل مشترك على طول المناطق الحدودية. وهنا يأتي دور الجمعية الإقليمية والمحلية الأورومتوسطية بكونها مجلس دائم ومشترك يمثل البعد دون الوطني في الاتحاد من أجل المتوسط، حيث يمكنها العمل كمنتدى أساسي لتبادل الممارسات وتمهيد الطريق. وتضم الضفاف الثلاث للبحر المتوسط بين جنباتها نماذج واعدة للمدن التي تتحول إلى الطاقة المتجددة والحلول الأكثر كفاءة في استخدام الطاقة من أجل الاحتياجات الحضرية. إن الجمعية الإقليمية الأورومتوسطية تضم وتجمع بين 80 من ممثل من الممثلين المحليين والإقليميين من شركاء الاتحاد الأوروبي ومنطقة البحر المتوسط، كما أنها تضمن مشاركة السلطات المحلية والإقليمية في الحوار السياسي الأورومتوسطي. وحالياً يتم الإعلان تباعاً عن مئات المشاريع المبتكرة. علاوة على ذلك، تسعى الجمعية الإقليمية والمحلية الأورومتوسطية إلى أن تثبت من خلال عملها أن السلطات المحلية رغم كل الصعوبات السياسية والمؤسسية قادرة على تشجيع وتدشين وتطوير مشاريع تعاون جديدة لمنفعة الناس على أرض الواقع. تهدف الجمعية إلى تشجيع وتعزيز الديمقراطية المحلية والحوكمة متعددة المستويات والتعاون اللامركزي على امتداد الضفاف الثلاث للبحر المتوسط. السيدات والسادة، إن المناطق العابرة للحدود تتمتع بإمكانية لأن تصبح مختبرات حقيقية لتجريب أساليب مبتكرة وتجريبية نحو التنمية المحلية المتكاملة وتكنولوجيات ونهج للاستجابة للتحديات المتعددة في المنطقة. ومن خلال تعاونها معا يمكنها تطوير اقتصاديات الحجم والإنتاج الكبير والتوصل إلى حلول مشتركة للاحتياجات الاجتماعية الملحة، ومن خلال الدخول في شراكة مع القطاع الخاص المحلي يمكنها إنعاش وتدعيم الاقتصاد المحلي. لتصبح عوامل حقيقية للتنمية المحلية ومن خلال تقوية الوعي والمسؤولية من جانب المجتمعات المحلية والإقليمية تجاه بيئاتها وأراضيها وثقافاتها ومن خلال اختياراتها فيما يتعلق بالطاقة يمكنها المساهمة في تبني التنافسية الإقليمية ومن خلال التحول إلى الاقتصاد الأخضر والدائري يمكنها تمهيد الطريق لفرص عمل جديدة ومنذ إنشائها في عام 2010 والجمعية الإقليمية الأورومتوسطية تعزز وتشجع على تبني نهج متعدد المستويات في سياسة الجوار الأوروبية وأقلمت السياسات القطاعية الأورومتوسطية وتقريبها أكثر من الناس وتقديم الدعم إلى اللامركزية وتدعيم الروابط بين اللامركزية السياسية والتنمية الإقليمية. يمكن للتعاون الأورومتوسطي الذي يتم في إطار سياسة الجوار الأوروبية المعدلة أن يلعب دوراً رئيسياً بهدف تحقيق طموحات السكان في النمو الاقتصادي وتوفير فرص العمل. يمكن للسلطات المحلية والإقليمية أن تصبح لاعباً أساسياً في هذا التعاون شريطة امتلاكها للموارد والمساعدة الفنية اللازمة. ويظهر نموذج السياسة الإقليمية الأوروبية أن الاستثمارات الموجهة في المناطق الأكثر حرماناً يمكن تعزيز قدراتها التنافسية وبالتالي إحداث النمو الاقتصادي وتوفير فرص العمل مع تحسين نوعية وجودة حياة السكان في الوقت ذاته. لا تزال الهجرة أحد القضايا المطروحة على طاولة مناقشاتنا وذلك من الجوانب الشمالية والشرقية والجنوبية لحوض المتوسط. تقف السلطات المحلية في كل من الاتحاد الأوروبي والبلدان المتوسطية على خط المواجهة للتعامل مع هذه الأزمة. وهناك حاجة على المستويين الوطني والدولي لمساعدة السلطات المحلية على استقبال ومساعدة وإدماج اللاجئين والمهاجرين. وعلى هامش الجلسة العامة للجمعية الإقليمية الأورومتوسطية في 22 و 23 فبراير شباط في 2017 في مالطا سنعقد مؤتمر مع الرئاسة المالطية للاتحاد الأوروبي نناقش فيه قضية الهجرة من وجهة نظر تقوية قدرة السلطات المحلية والإقليمية على التعامل مع هذه القضايا. الزملاء المحترمين، فمن المقدر أن بحلول 2017 سيعيش 72% من سكان البحر المتوسط في مناطق حضرية، ويتمثل الخطر في أن ذلك سيؤدي إلى مستوطنات غير رسمية لا يمكن التحكم فيها، وما يرتبط بذلك من مشكلات خاصة بالتدهور ونقص تقديم الخدمات ونقص التقدم. وفي ضوء هذا التطور ركزت الجمعية الإقليمية والمحلية الأورومتوسطية على التنمية الحضرية المستدامة موصية بتبني نهج متعدد العناصر الفاعلة والذي يتضمن كافة العناصر الفاعلة في التخطيط الحضري، ومشددة على أهمية الحوكمة الرشيدة واللامركزية، وكذلك الحاجة إلى التركيز على تخطيط وتطوير المدن متوسطة الحجم. وأخيراً، يمكن أن تساعد اللامركزية وإصلاح الإدارة العامة في تقليل الفساد وتنفيذ استراتيجيات التنمية الإقليمية وتنمية المناطق. وفي هذا الصدد أود أن أؤكد على أن الجمعية الإقليمية المحلية الأورومتوسطية ستستمر في دعمها السياسي والعمل عن كثب مع المشاركين في تحالف المشروع مثل الاتحاد من أجل المتوسط UFM وشبكة المدن الساحلية في منطقة البحر المتوسط Mid Cities من أجل مزيد من التطوير لمشروع مشترك عن بناء القدرات من أجل تنمية حضرية مستدامة ومتكاملة والذي يتضمن العديد من بلدان البحر الأبيض المتوسط، يؤدي تبادل أفضل الممارسات في مجالات متعددة للتعاون إلى تحقيق قيمة مضافة للعمل السياسي لكافة السلطات الوطنية المشاركة. وهناك مثال آخر لتعاون مشابه سيتمثل في تقوية قدرات البلديات الليبية في إطار مبادرة نيقوسية والتي تتألف من تنظيم ندوات من نظير لنظير بين رؤساء المدن الليبية وأعضاء لجنة المناطق والممثلين المنتخبين للمناطق والمدن الأوروبية. ونحن نرى مع شركائنا التأثير القوي والفوائد وكذلك الإمكانيات الضخمة لهذا النوع من التعاون، وقد تم حتى الآن تدريب ما يقارب من 50 من السلطات الليبية في هذه التجربة الرائدة، وتم تنظيم تدريبات في 7 ندوات حول الموضوعات التالية: إدارة المياه، إدارة المخلفات، إدارة مراكز الرعاية الصحية، إعادة المواضيع التاريخية لسابق عهدها، التحكم الإداري وتقييم الأداء، القضايا المتعلقة بالتنظيف وإدارة الصحة، إدارة الموارد البشرية. ولإكمال ذلك، فإننا نعمل حالياً مع عدد من مدارس الإدارة العامة الأوروبية المرموقة من أجل دعم وتطوير وحدات تدريبية للسلطات المحلية، والتي توصل في النهاية إلى برنامج رئيسي للسلطات المحلية الليبية، أمل أن يفتح برنامج التعاون عبر حدود منطقة البحر المتوسط أبوابه للسلطات المحلية الليبية، فلا يوجد سبب آخر لترك رفاقنا خلفنا. السيدات والسادة، أرجو أن تسمحوا لي بأن أذكر بإيجاز عدداً من التوصيات لمزيد من تطوير البرامج في مشاريع التعاون عبر الحدود في منطقة البحر المتوسط، وهي مستقاة من دراسة تم التكليف بإجراها من قبل الجمعية الإقليمية والمحلية الأورومتوسطية. أولاً، قاعدة بيانات معرفية متسقة. سيكون من المفيد تطوير قاعدة بيانات مخصصة لأدوات المراقبة، حيث سيتم تجميع النتائج والملاحظات الرئيسية من كل مشروع بغرض مشاركة المعارف والخبرات وتقليل أو تجنب التجربة والخطأ. وفي هذا الصدد، فإننا نقترح تطوير منصة معلومات على الإنترنت تتسم بالكفاءة، ومنح كل عالم أو قائد مشروع إمكانية وصول مجانية. استراتيجيات مراقبة بسيطة. العمليات المنظمة والمكونة جيداً والمفهومة بسهولة يمكن أن تكون قابلة للتكرار، وهذا مفيد لكل من العلماء والجهات المعنية. وعلى ذلك، وخلال مرحلة التطوير، يجب أن لا يتم التقليل من أهمية البساطة والوضوح. المؤشرات المشتركة مع مراعاة الفروق بين البلدان وتباين البيانات من حالة لأخرى، سيكون من المفيد استخدام مؤشرات مماثلة في مجال قياس معين. لذلك، فإن أدوات مراقبة جودة المياه ينبغي أن تستخدم مؤشرات مماثلة عبر جميع المشاريع. التواصل مع العامة. إن الأفكار التي يتم تنفيذها في كثيرة من هذه المشاريع لا تقتصر فقط على دعم المراقبة البيئية، ولكن يتم استخدام النتائج لأغراض مشاركة العامة وأنشطة التثقيف وزيادة الوعي لكل من السياح والمواطنين. وتتسم البيانات الآنية بقيمة عظيمة، ونتيجة لذلك يمكن تحفيز المجتمع لتحمل المسؤولية فيما يتعلق بإجراءات حماية البيئة. التعاون العابر للحدود الوطنية، بالإضافة إلى أهداف برنامجية محددة، فإن كثيراً من هذه المشاريع قد دشنت أو دعمت العلاقات بين شركاء وبلدان ضفتي البحر المتوسط. وبعد إنشاء هذه الجسور من الأهداف والنتائج الأساسية، لأن الفروق بين هذه البلدان كبيرة فيما يتعلق بالقضايا الاقتصادية والثقافية والاجتماعية. ومن المفيد بدرجة كبيرة الحفاظ على هذه الجسور بعد إتمام المشروع. المشاركين المحترمين، أود أن أختم كلمتي بصفتي الرئيس المشارك للجمعية الإقليمية والمحلية الأورومتوسطية بالقول أنه من خلال الحوار المكثف وتبادل الخبرات، فقد ساهمت الجمعية على مدار السنوات الست الماضية في تفعيل إمكانيات السلطات المحلية في بلدان المتوسط من أجل تحقيق الحوكمة الرشيدة باعتبارها من المتطلبات المسبقة للنمو الاقتصادي والفرص الاستثمارية والتعاون القطاعي. وأنا أشجعكم وأحثكم على المشاركة مع الجمعية الإقليمية الأورومتوسطية والمساهمة بخبراتكم الخاصة في أعمالنا. شكراً لكم جميعاً.
Before closing the session, I have a short room for remarks of Ambassador Saad and of Ambassador Marras. Please.
Thank you very much. One of the main parameters that have governed our cooperation discussions, you know, all through the implementation of the CBC was that we don't get into any political analysis of the situation in any country. And because simply it is distractive, it distracts us, our discussions, from our main purposes, and would lead to unnecessary problems and unnecessary debates. So that's why I think we were wise enough in order to avoid, you know, any kind of qualification or analysis of the situation. I was taken by surprise by my friend from Palestine when he described the situation in Egypt. I don't know how it was interpreted, a case of instability. And I'm not here to get into that. I'm not questioning his intention. I'm sure that was in a good faith. But nevertheless, I think that was totally incorrect politically, because it attacks, you know, terrorist attacks happen in Europe, happened, and we expect them, unfortunately, to happen. They happened in Egypt, they happened in Spain, in UK, in Belgium, in France, but that does not lead us to qualify that the situation is unstable. In fact, that led my friend, that I want to thank him, but I will not, the Alex, you know, he put Syria, Libya, Egypt as unstable countries. And this is, I think it's a political mistake of appreciation. I think it's quite advisable that we should not get into that. And you could, on the contrary, Egypt now is one of the very few countries left with institutional consolidation, with political and economic vision, and with a 4.3 growth rate. And we know that we have difficulties, and we'll continue to have difficulties, but we know that we are on the right track towards development, peace, and stability. So I just wanted to make this remark in order for future discussions to avoid such kind of qualifications, which I'm very unfortunately was totally incorrect. Thank you.
Thank you. Grazie. I would like to pass the speech to our Italian ambassador Marras, please.
Thank you very much. I just take the floor to say that me and my colleagues at the embassy are very grateful for the invitation. We have learned something important for us. Let me wish the reinforcement of the instrument, and let me wish that the instrument can be that more people could be aware of the instrument. It's a matter of communication, to communicate to the right people, that to everyone, that there are opportunities in this instrument which are very important for their well-being, for values on which we can build a stable and prosperous Mediterranean. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. Thank you.
Can we welcome, you know, if I may, sorry to interrupt. We would like to welcome our dear friend, the Egyptian ambassador to Athens, His Excellency Ambassador Farid Munib, who promised to come 5 hours earlier, but no, he couldn't make it. But I'm really honored and blessed.
We are on the Mediterranean hours, everybody. Anyway, thank you to everybody that attend to this session. We can conclude anyway with the positive message that came today from ENI and CBC projects and of the people that here make their speeches and they tell their stories, their real stories. That and the message is that this project can demonstrate that the real project, the real life of the people, and the good and the most important tool that they show is a cultural tool. They can overcome every problem. They can overcome the prejudice and the hate. This is the lesson that came to us from our testimonial today and from this project of INEAI CBCI. Thank you very much indeed. And there is a coffee break, and then there is, you are invited for the second session of the debate. Thank you.